Good morning.
Good morning.
Good to be in worship this fine Sunday. Just a few brief announcements. July 24th, I will be on vacation. And I don't know how many of you may have met Pastor Jeff Shirley or not. He's been one of the poll watchers since they moved to town. And his wife, he is a covenant denomination pastor who moved back to Shenandoah in retirement. And I've asked him to lead us in worship on that Sunday, the 24th. Then the 31st is our annual joint service with St. Paul's. And I know not all of you go down to St. Paul's on that Sunday. So I encourage you to go to another one of our services in the community and encourage and support those congregations with your presence. And August 7th, we then also have our joint worship here in Shenandoah at McCullen Park. So we're looking forward to that. And I just like you to imagine or think about that as an opportunity to invite someone to come and worship with us. Now, they don't have to come into the building. They will just be in the park. And they can rest as they like and come and be a part of this worshiping family or get a taste of what it is to be gathered with an annual church. So that coming up, 24th, 31st, and 7th. Today we will have Second Communion after the worship service. We've begun collecting school supplies, and the noisy offering for this month is the Shenandoah Women's Resource and Pregnancy Center. So we want to support that. They're actually looking at putting up a building and expanding that service in the community. And today at 5 o'clock, we have a great fellowship event out to the Richardson Place. Steve is hosting us to have a meal out there. So, show up at 5 o'clock or 6, and at least, you know, get to the time for s'mores. So, look forward to that. See you. Well, I invite you to stand as able. This is the day the Lord has made.
We will rejoice and be glad in it.
Thanks be to God. Please. Acknowledge everyone's presence with a wave. We're sitting a little closer. You can shake hands if you want. Get closer to everyone. We're glad to be here. We begin our worship. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose steadfast love endures forever.
Amen.
Let's confess our sins in the presence of God and one another. Merciful God,
we confess that we have not followed your path, but have chosen our own way. Instead of putting others before ourselves, we quickly take the best seats at the table. When encountering those in need, we have too often passed by on the other side. Set us again on the path of life, the abundant and generous life you desire for us. Save us from complacency.
Here's the good news. God does not deal with us according to our sins, but rather delights in granting mercy and grace. In the name of Jesus Christ, I declare to you, your sins are forgiven. May the Holy Spirit guide and keep you in all truth, and may you be free to love others as God loves you.
Thanks be to God.
Jesus calls us over the turmoil, so I gather this up.
Thank you.
Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
It is not up in heaven, so distant that you must ask, who will go to heaven and bring it down so we can hear and obey it? It is not beyond the sea, so far away that you must ask, who will cross the sea to bring it to us so that we can hear and obey it? The message is very close at hand. It is on your lips and in your heart so that you can obey it. Now listen, today I'm giving you a choice between life and death, between prosperity and disaster. For I command you this day to love the Lord your God and keep his commands, decrees, and regulations by walking in his ways. If you do this, you will live and multiply, and the Lord your God will bless you and the land you are about to enter and occupy. But if your heart turns away and you refuse to listen, and if you are drawn away to serve and worship other gods, then I warn you now that you will certainly be destroyed. You will not live a long, good life in the land you are crossing to the Jordan to occupy. The word of God, words of life.
Thanks be to God.
Today's responsive reading is taken from Psalm 25, verses 1 through 10. Let us proclaim God's faithfulness as we read responsibly. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. I trust in you, my God.
Do not let me be disgraced, or let my enemies rejoice in my defeat.
No one who trusts in you will ever be disgraced.
But disgrace comes to those who try to deceive others.
Show me the path where I should walk, O Lord.
Point out the right road for me to follow.
Lead me by your truth and teach me, for you are a God who saves me.
All day long I put my hope in you.
Remember, O Lord, your unfailing love and compassion,
which you have shown from long ages past.
Forgive the rebellious sins of my youth.
Look instead in the eyes of your unfailing love, for you are merciful, O Lord.
The Lord is good and does what is right.
He shows the proper path to those who go astray.
He leads the humble in what is right.
He is teaching them his ways.
The Lord leads with unfailing love and faithfulness.
All those who keep his covenant and obey his decrees.
Today's second reading is Paul's commendation for the believers in Colossae who received the truth about God's great love for sinners. He rejoices for their transformation and other work the Holy Spirit is doing through believers. The reading from the Colossians chapter 1, beginning with verse 1. Greetings from Paul. This letter is from Paul, chosen by God to be an apostle of Christ Jesus, and from our brother Timothy. It is written to God's holy people in the city of Colossae, who are faithful brothers and sisters in Christ. May God our Father give you grace and peace. We always pray for you, and we give thanks to God the Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard that you trust in Christ Jesus, and you have love for all of God's people. You do this because you are looking forward to the joys of heaven, as you have been ever since you first heard the truth of the good news. This same good news that came to you is going out over all the world. It is changing lives everywhere, just as it changed yours that very first day you heard and understood the truth about God's great kindness to sinners. Epaphras, our much-loved co-worker, was the one who brought you the good news. He is Christ's faithful servant, and he is helping us in your peace. He is the one who told us about the great love for others that the Holy Spirit has given you. So we have continued praying for you ever since we first heard about you. We ask God to give you a complete understanding of what he wants to do in your lives, and we ask him to make you wise with spiritual wisdom. Then the way you live will always honor and please the Lord, and you will continually do good, kind things for others. All the while you will learn to know God better and better. We also pray that you will be strengthened with his glorious power so that you will have all the patience and endurance that you need. You will be filled with joy, always thanking the Father who has enabled you to share the inheritance that belongs to God's holy people who live in the light. For he has rescued us from the one who rules in the kingdom of darkness, and he has brought us into the kingdom of his dear Son. God has purchased our freedom with his blood and has forgiven all our sins. The word of God, words of life.
Thanks be to God.
There's a question that parents ask their children, I think, with unspoken prayer that they will answer correctly. It's a simple question. If Billy jumped off the bridge, would you do the same? And we hope that our child sees the danger, values their own life and safety enough that, no, I'm not going to be stupid like Billy. And I think it's a theme that connects our lessons today. God is reaching out, calling us to come to Him, to live in a relationship close to Him and drawing strength and hope. And then we won't be troubled or suffer some of the consequences of our actions if we're careful. Why is that? And therefore, the prayer, this verse from Psalm, today's Psalm. Show me the path where I should walk, O Lord. Point out the right road for me to follow. Let that be our prayer. Humbly follow God and trust in Him to give us that safe place. Let's pray.
Dear Lord Jesus,
give us voice.
To speak to those who wander.
May they hear the kindness and grace of Jesus as we speak, seeking to correct their path, bringing them to joy and security. Would you stand for a gospel acclamation? Next time I am here. And Jesus asked, which of these three would you say was the neighbor to the man who was attacked by bandits? The man replied, the one who showed him mercy. And Jesus said, yes, now you go and do the same. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Well, we all have occasions to be good Samaritans, also occasions when we were not moved to help someone in need, rather passed by. Not necessarily that we are hard-hearted, but there are times when we're so personally drained that we couldn't imagine how we could be of help to anyone in such great need. And also, when I pray this is the case, you recall with joy occasions when you were inwardly surprised that you had the emotional fortitude to stop and help a stranger in need. Fortified with faith and hopefulness for them, which could only come from God at work in you. Now, I don't have firsthand experience of the farm crisis of the 80s, certainly a time when neighbors needed to look after neighbors. All were suffering. But I did live through that time and suffered the effects of inflation and high interest rates. In 1977, 78, and 79, I managed Lake Run Rock Arena for my parents. We had a nice accessory store, parts and service department, boat sales, fuel and concessions on the water, and maintained the docks. We leased to the people who kept their boat there on the water. All this activity, but we didn't turn a profit. So, when late in 1979, somebody wanted to lease and perhaps buy the marina for my parents, they went with them, which meant I would be out of a job come the next season. Except that the owner of Sailorville Marina, north of Des Moines, who was kind of ramping up things there at that time, he came down and paid me a visit. He heard we would be leasing the marina, and he heard what a good job I was doing there. So he came down to interview me and offer me responsibility for boat and accessory sales in his marina. I'd have less hats to wear. Besides, the owner and the bookkeeper were the only other people who'd be working in that building. I wouldn't have people to supervise. Building up on the hill, away from the docks. Why I wasn't suspicious, I really don't have an answer for, except perhaps that I was so flattered by this person seeking me out, and I had the skills that he needed. I started in February setting up the new accessory store. I wrote my first newsletter article to introduce myself in this new activity at Sailorville Marina and lettered them out to all the current customers and slip people who rented slips about the boat sales. All that would be available for them at this hilltop marina building. I felt like the lawyer in this week's episode of Jesus Ministry. All connected with most of the answers for my upper-class voting customers. That's what a teacher of the law was skilled at. Well, he could teach anybody about the law of Moses. But by the time I found other employment, I felt like the man stripped and beaten and left along the side of the road. I had been offered a generous sales commission on boat sales. So So without thinking, I accepted a salary of $100 a month. And with inflation and interest rates in 1980, nobody was buying boats. I sold one boat in the 10 months that I invested in that endeavor. Despite my best efforts, I quickly spent our reserves, was going in debt. Praise be to God that McDonald's was looking for experienced managers. Of the characters in this episode of Jesus' ministry we look at today, where this lawyer asked Jesus a question, a person who's generally comfortable and feels he can test Jesus with a question. Maybe he's the one we should focus on, not the Good Samaritan or the priest or the Levite, but the one that Jesus really is concerned about and trying to help to grow in faith and receive that gift of salvation, to appreciate what it is that God is doing for him. Perhaps we should rethink and realize in many ways we're like that lawyer. American churches have long suffered the ill effects of affluence. From the 50s and continuing to a lesser degree today, membership and active participation in the life of the church offered significant social status. You were rubbing shoulders with, and you were raising your children with people who were connected, the upper class of the community, or so it seemed to many. And this isn't contrary to God's grace and forgiveness of our sins being one's primary motivation for active participation and contribution to the life of the church. Coming to worship to grow in knowledge of God's love, relationship with Jesus, and receive growing understanding of God's will for providing abundant life and salvation for all the world, these reasons produce a greater benefit for being active in the family of God than the attraction of social connection. I believe Jesus mentions that the Jewish priest, the temple assistant, who passed by the injured man on the far side of the road, I believe Jesus mentioned them because they were of the same social class as this lawyer. In fact, from the lawyer's perspective, he might even admire them for their closeness to God, for their service to God. But in Jesus' story, he contrasts them with a person that the lawyer wouldn't associate with at all, a Samaritan. Our translation says despised Samaritan. And that distinction really draws attention to the radical new way for us to understand what Jesus calls for in our responsibility to fellow humanity. What Jesus asks of us in light of what he has done for us on the cross. In my ordained role as pastor, I declare to all who gather the entire forgiveness of all your sins and the power of the cross, what God has done for us. I'm called to teach through preaching and Bible study God's mercy and desire for life redeeming relationship with you. We hear from God's word each week. Words that fortify us in understanding of God's mercy and desire to bless our lives with abundance that the world cannot give. For God provides through ordinary folks like you and I, through the church. We gather to lift our concerns, the concerns of our heart, up to God in prayer. You receive these gifts not on the basis of social status or being family, but rather simply that God loves you. And God has made himself known to you enough that you, I pray, pray, desire for more of Him, to know Him more, to know more about this kingdom and the forgiveness of sins. And that He takes what would be a stumbling block, our sins, our doubts, stumbling block to believing that God's love is powerful enough to do what the world cannot do, to actually redeem us, give us healing of our heart and our soul. Whatever's the stumbling block, Jesus throws as far away as the east is from the west. And frankly, I am concerned for the future of our churches. Many of you expressed your concerns. I don't know what to do to improve attendance and giving. And actually, you have more influence on your friends and neighbors than I do. But I'm always welcome to join. Glad to join the conversation. Let them know that the kingdom of God has come near to them. We seem to lack understanding of how and an urgency regarding announcing and demonstrating to our neighbors and friends the spiritual and other benefits of participating in the life of the church, and maybe in ways that are a mystery to us, to you. Worthy of research, worthy of asking. Asking in prayer to begin with, for God to reveal to you more of His grace, His peace, His love, His mercy. What we notice about the lawyer is the faith he wanted to practice required no sacrifice. He wanted Jesus to tell him he could feel good about himself without going outside of his comfort zone. Be comfortable in his own accomplishments, his social position. The Samaritan, in Jesus' example, had something even more than that, though. Something that Jesus wants for us all to have. He not only knew God's mercy for himself, but he had grace to put it into action, even for strangers. Jesus was trying to help the lawyer live out the answer to his first question, which was, what must I do to receive eternal life? And God had told him. Jesus asked him, what does the law of Moses say? And you're familiar with these words. You must love the Lord your God with all of your heart, all of your soul, all of your strength, and all of your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. Right, Jesus told him. Do this. Live this. And you will live. You'll find that abundant life that Jesus wants us to have. Jesus calls us to operate not on a head knowledge, on an intellectual faith, but rather doing likewise as Jesus has done. And he mentions about the Samaritan having freedom, kind of challenging us. He desires that we be empowered by faith in what He has done for you, empowered by knowledge and appreciation of what of God who is gracious, not condemning, but rather always holding out His hand to lift us up and walk with Him, even when we have preferred to walk apart from Him for a while. He's still holding out His hand, calling us to come and trust in Him. We take from this that we are not to come to church to feel good about what we have done. We come to offer our thanks and praise for all that God is doing and has done for us. All that He adds to our life through faith and trust in Him. Today's question is simple. How big and powerful is your God? Is your understanding of Jesus, our Lord? Does He only operate within your comfort zone? Or does He sometimes move you a little beyond that, being so inclusive and powerful that our human self becomes uncomfortable, yet our God self is empowered to do good for others, not out of our own, but from within the shelter of God's love and God's grace. We don't have to go out and do it first and then God will like us. No, He loves us and He walks with us. And He's with us in helping that stranger, our neighbor. Our Lord is looking for revival. Will the church be ready to participate and help people to find the God that we worship? I believe that's what God is calling our churches to today, not to circle the wagons and hope we can hang on until we're buried and committed to God's eternal care. That's not a church people want to join or be a part of. Doesn't offer hope to our children. Only a request that they be faithful until they fulfill their obligation to you. The church people want to be a part of is one which worships God in power and majesty and grace and forgiveness. All those things that the world is not doing for humanity. God revealed the lives of believers going and doing likewise, who have the light of faith burning within them to go and help people in need, to share a word of hope about God's love. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we give you thanks that you have revealed yourself to us. Lord, we pray for your church, your work, in our personal lives, and in the churches of the body. Lord, may we reveal your grace and love as you strengthen us for all the world needs. We trust in you, our Lord Jesus, to whom belongs all honor and glory. Amen. On Heaven Day, immortal and visible.
Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary, he suffered under Pontius Pilate, was
crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. And on the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Point of the liturgy that we still mark, even though we are not passing plates. Part of the response, hearing God's word, we want to be a part of what God is doing, and we present our offerings as a way of being part, contributing to the work of God, work of this local church and the greater church, and work done in the community. So I invite and encourage those who are worshiping at home to have your offering in. We'll be grateful for the support that allows us to continue to gather in this fine place. Let us pray. God of abundance,
you have set before us a plentiful harvest, and as we feast on your goodness, strengthen us to labor in your good field, and equip us to bear fruit to the good of all, in the love we receive through Jesus Christ. Amen.
Let us sing our offertory. I do invite you to stand for this.
Thank you for those you've raised up to care for the marginalized in our community. make effective the services for school students, residents, and aides in our care centers, the unemployed and working poor. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
We give thanks for the saints, past and present, who revealed your love and mercy with word and actions. Inspired by their witness, strengthen us to serve others with compassion. God of grace,
hear our prayer.
God of every time and place, in Jesus' name, and filled with your Holy Spirit, we entrust these spoken prayers and those in our hearts into your holy keeping. Amen. Please stand for the Lord's Prayer.
With one voice, we pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Comfort you, work healing in you this day and always.
Amen.